Welcome to the Watchdog Report. As usual, my name is Ed Ciffone, hasn't changed. They call me the Yorktown Watchdog and President of the United Taxpayers of Yorktown. So, tonight, we're going to have a special guest, Carolee Sunderland, who used to be a former Commissioner of Board of Elections. So, Carolee, nice to see you, Ed. Carolee. Did I say Carolee? I don't think so. Carolee.
That's common.
Okay, Carolee. Remind me if I mess up again. But Carolee, you've been retired now how long?
Just a little over 2 years.
Okay, so tell us what the Commissioner of Board of Election does or did when you were in there, and why do you think it's a good system, or if it's working correct?
Well, at the time I started, which was over 20 years ago, we only had 28 people. Oh. When I left, we had in the neighborhood of 70 plus, and that was not the election day workers. That was permanent workers. Mm-hmm. I have no idea what it is now. I know it is higher. We saw it go from a very minor operation with a lot to do to a huge. Obviously, with the different laws that were passed and the big optic scan machines that were demanded to be used as of 2 years ago, there was no choice in the matter. There was a big change over on staff and how many people you needed, and a lot of other things. So I saw a big change over that 20 years.
So let's start off about people voting. Mm-hmm. One of the most important things you're right to do. Now, you were there 20 years. What percentage of people voted over those 20 years? It got better or got worse?
I believe it got worse.
Got worse.
Now, we did have more people that were residents, and therefore, usually the percentage of registered voters went up. Okay. But compared to before I even got involved with politics, predecessors used to talk about when it was more local, it was smaller. I almost say like a mom and pop running of the election that day. Everybody knew everyone. Mm-hmm. More people voted as everyone's life became more on the fast track.
Right.
And it seemed like less people were voting. And it didn't matter what the board or sometimes parties did or candidates did. You just couldn't get over that threshold.
Right. So how does it work? There's two commissioners, co-commissioners? Is that how it works now?
Yes.
And when you were, was two co-commissioners the same way?
There's two commissioners because of the way New York State election law is written, that the boards of elections within the state of New York are... and I don't like to use the word controlled, but that's kind of what it is, by the two major parties in the four-year given cycle of a gubernatorial, which means whoever are the two top vote getters, which are usually Republican, Democrat, Democrat, Republican, they run the Board of Elections, but it is run for every voter. It doesn't matter what you're registered in. And that's a concept that a lot of people have a problem with because they think the commissioners are only going to help Republicans, are only going to help Democrats, whether they be candidates or voters.
Well,
and
I know,
that's not true.
I know when I ran, all I talked to was the Republican Party people. And that was some experience. Maybe you could tell people, I don't know if it's changed in the last 2 years since you're out, but I got a package of all the different filings you had to file and the instructions of how to run. And then I realized that the head of the Republican Party was the commissioner, and the head of the Democratic Party was a Democratic commissioner, which I thought there was a major conflict with that, okay? It could be a worker on both sides, but the head of the party. So the only reason why I'm telling you this is because I've been a district leader for 19 and a half years, so I decided I wanted to run, but I didn't get the endorsement of my own party. They decide to endorse a Democrat and a conservative over me. So when I ran, I had a primary. So that was exciting there. And then I had to get signatures. That's part of the thing. And I got the signatures, and then my own party challenged me and knocked me off the ballot for not having the signatures. So I think you've told me, and I believe this, you really have to have a manager, that's number one, and probably a lawyer. Because when they tell you things that you don't know, you need a lawyer immediately. Because they sent me a letter that you have 3 days to appeal, but they sent me the letter the same day that was the last day to appeal. So, you know, so I called the lawyer, said, what am I going to do? It's today and that's it. But they have all these rules and regulations and stuff like that. So, tell the voters out there, if they wanted to run for office, what would be the first thing that they need to do and the options they have of being on the ballot? Regular candidate, primaries, independent candidate, and all that stuff. Do you remember all that?
Well, that's a very lengthy question, but I will try to break it down.
Yeah, just break it,
again.
Yeah.
Yes, most candidates, when they come, I used to tell them, you do try to get your party affiliation, whatever it is, their endorsement. If you're an independent, you still must decide what party you'd like to run in or for. And you seek that out. In your case, it was not given to you, so you went the route of challenging them,
right,
by doing your own petition and carrying through.
Right.
The second thing, whether you're going to get your party nod or not, I usually used to tell people, and I still do if I'm asked, you have to get yourself a good treasurer, someone you can trust, and you are not should not be the one to sign any checks.
Right.
That's number one. Number two, get a good campaign manager, and that's the person that's going to keep everything focused and do the day-to-day work. There's a lot of candidates that don't do this, and then they end up having to do it, and you can't be a campaign manager and a candidate, in my book, at the same time.
I found that.
Right. And thirdly, yes, get yourself a lawyer, but make sure you get one that is somewhat knowledgeable in election law. It is a narrow window. There are a few lawyers that's all they do,
mm-hmm,
but most of them do it because they enjoy it. They are politically involved, but they do have other practices.
Right.
I will say there's some, especially out of Albany, that's all they do, but they usually work for the Senate or the Assembly or whatever.
Right.
So, if you have a friend that, you know, might be a real estate lawyer, that's wonderful. But if he has no knowledge of election law, it's very hard to learn it on the cuff.
The United Taxpayers, we've ran for the last 4 years, four different people. And this last year I tried to run. But the parties wouldn't endorse. Nick DiTomaso, you're going to be on his show later on, he ran for councilman. They didn't endorse him. There's a lady named Kathy D'Amato, who was a Republican, they didn't endorse her. There was another lady, Linda Comenzo, who was an independent. She wanted to stay independent. So we had her go as a write-in candidate,
mm-hmm,
which is like impossible.
Write-ins are very difficult.
Right. And then they don't even count your votes to 6 weeks later. In this last election, I kept calling and calling. They wouldn't tell me how many votes I had. The first time I went, during the primary, I went down there for about 7 hours. Because they go through all the different things. Then.
Mm-hmm.
And then if they write your name wrong, they throw it out. If, you know, they spell it wrong, if they don't put it in a box, this was killing me, you know? So, what I had to do is I had to make a card up on it, and they have it here, a little box showing my name and where to put it in there.
Mm-hmm.
And then with the new voting machines, with that ink pen, it's really hard to get it in there. So I know I lost a lot of stuff like that. And then it says vote for two. Now this is what really got me. Vote for two, so you have two votes, okay? So why couldn't they vote for me twice? And people did that. They voted, because they allowed two votes, they voted for me twice. But they threw one out. They were gonna throw the whole
Correct.
Thing out.
And that's the law.
Yeah, they're gonna throw the whole thing
we
out.
We don't have cumulative voting.
Right, right. Yeah,
and so the only village that does is Portchester.
Holy
and they won that court case a number of years ago,
right,
which cumulative voting is not in New York State.
Yeah.
It is not something I believe in if the whole county or the whole state isn't going to do it. And I'm not in favor of it.
Right.
Number one, there is no machine made in for New York State that you can
do
cumulative voting.
Right.
So they were correct in throwing one out and giving you one.
Okay.
The reason it was vote for two, I'm going backwards here with your questions.
Yeah, yeah.
The vote for two was because when you challenge or you primary the office, you don't primary the person, you're primarying the office. So therefore, if the Republicans have two people and you are the challenger, it has to say vote for two, because you don't know who you're going to run against. You've opened up the office.
Yeah.
Write-ins are extremely difficult.
Oh,
I've always told people that with the new machines, as to waiting 6 weeks, it's very possible, because the thing is written on the ballot.
Right.
The old machine, you wrote it on the top where there was paper
right,
roll.
Right, right.
The paper would be ripped out. You could come and look at it.
Right.
You could examine it. And then usually about maybe 2 weeks, depending on how heavy the election was. But usually within 2 to 3 weeks, we had a specific date, a specific time, and you came and we counted them.
Yeah.
So that's the difference because of the paper ballot and a paper roll.
Yeah.
The last part, which you indicated about the spelling.
Yes.
Again, there's election law that states if there is an incumbent, they do have an advantage that they can just write in their last name. It doesn't have to have the full name.
Right.
All right. Now, the criteria breaks down at that point. If you're new and you've never ran before, but yet you have palm cards, you have things that you've passed out, we know you're running, and there's a little deviation on the spelling, it was the commissioner's authority that said, yes, we will give him that vote. So that's something you have to talk to the board about, because we were pretty, you know, easygoing, especially if it was a hard name to spell.
Right.
Sometimes there were very long names to spell. Sometimes
they
were hyphenated names.
Right, right.
And lastly, placement on the paper roll, if it was not in the correct column, it could not be counted. Again, that's election law.
Right.
Again, I believe it's probably the same for a paper ballot, because there is a specific spot you have to write.
Well, that was it. The people didn't know where to sign.
Right.
Especially with the paper ballot.
Yes.
You had to lift up this thing and make sure you're in line and all that other stuff. But this new machine, first of all, the commissioner is the head of the Republican Party. So I didn't know that until I got down there.
Mm-hmm.
Since my Republican Party didn't endorse me, I felt there was a conflict of interest there. He's a nice guy, okay? Mainly told me what had to be done and stuff like that, but I didn't like that at all. So he has two hats. He's the commissioner and the head of the Westchester County Republicans. Same thing for the Democratic side,
mm-hmm.
right? Yeah, so that was a little conflict there. Now, on the new machines that they have, now, when you vote, and you turn it over? Turn the paper
mm-hmm.
over?
The ballot, I should say.
Okay. It inks right through.
I know it did it the first year. I thought they corrected that.
They're still doing it. Because and if you were an observer, or I don't know what you could do with that information, but if it was all Republicans, you could see the line right in a row.
Oh, you mean filling in the little round circle?
Round circle, because it goes through.
Mm-hmm.
And then a lot of times... mine didn't work. It didn't work like the third time.
Mm-hmm.
So just paper alone seems like that must have cost a fortune for that.
It's stepping back in time. That's what I call it.
Stepping back in time, yeah. So, but, you know, it's a new thing. And what we see a lot of times is in all elections that people vote that are not registered voters. And with the new... Lord is trying to do for identification, you know, before somebody votes, and I agree with that. I don't see there's anything wrong against people's rights if you had your driver's license, if it adds up and stuff like that. But I've seen over the past years, you know, people that are dead, I don't know who writes them in, or we hear about that. other people signing in. They could sign in right there at the local elections and school board elections. If they don't have a card or anything like that, they sign in, then they fill out a form.
Well, can it's, I just, I, yeah, if just, I can address that, the yeah. school boards are not run by the Board of Elections as of right now. I know that there is probably talk, because there's always been talk, especially with the new machines, because you cannot, or the board cannot, any board in the county, in the state, excuse me, cannot have outside people programming those machines.
Right.
So consequently, it's almost like a half marriage. The school board runs it, but they have to use our machines. We have to get their ballot done for them. And I think it's a matter of time, and it'll probably all be turned over to the Board of Elections, which you're absolutely right. Their rules for registering are much different than the state and the federal level. So that's one problem.
Yeah.
Another problem is when you register to vote, and it started in around mid-80s, the Voters' Rights Act, the motor voter, for lack of another, that came along. It was to open up the process. And at present, when you register, if you do not give them either a license or non-driver license number, or the last four digits of your Social Security, when they check it out to see, it's a flag that's put in the book. And on election day, if you're a first-time voter, which you would be if you registered, you're supposed to show proof that first time. Now, the proof, and this is where there's a leeway that I don't agree with, starts out with your license or your passport and goes down to a federal statement that you get with your name and address, a piece of paper from Social Security or something. And I disagree with that part of it. I think it should be something, but not quite down to the level of a piece of paper.
Right.
The other thing, as far as people that pass away, we have an issue with people that pass out of state because not all states reciprocate back to New York State that these people have passed away. And in their infinite wisdom, the legislators, a number of years ago, put into the election law that the registrars, which are your town clerks and your city clerks, don't have to tell the Board of Elections anymore. At one time, that's how we got our information.
Oh, okay.
Because they have to sign off on those deaths.
Right.
Well, they don't have to. Many of them still do help. But the law says they don't really have to. So you've taken almost, in Westchester, something like 28 places that you can get information from.
Mm-hmm.
The third thing is, when every year everybody gets a card in the mail that says, this is your name, this is your address, this is where you vote, and gives you a little information.
Remind me to tell you about that this last election.
Well, it says up on the top, please return to, I don't know the exact words, but in other words, return it to the Board of Elections if this person no longer lives there.
Right.
Well, do you know what most people do when they see, oh, Carolee Sunderland, she doesn't live here? It goes in the garbage. You're telling the Board of Elections, I still live there.
Right.
And that's why the new law stated you can't remove those people because you didn't get the, because you they kept the card.
Right, right.
And I used to have that question so many times with people that had children that were in college, then decided not to come home and lived out of state. Well, my first question was, what do you do with that card when you get it? And 9 out of 10 times it was, why I threw it out. Did you read it? Because if you sent it back to us, we then can start the cancellation process. But these were all the new laws, which they called from about mid-80s on, to make people vote more. And it, in my book, didn't really help. It caused more work for the Board of Elections, and it was needless work instead of work that really needed to get done. And it just was fuel for the media as to why the board was keeping people from voting or letting everybody vote. Well, and those are only some of the problems. The last piece is the machines. I would say probably 99% of all the commissioners at the time that the machines or the new programming or what type of machines it was going to be were chosen. It was taken out of the hands of the commissioners and mm-hmm. given back to the lawmakers in Albany, and they picked the optic scan. Mm-hmm. Commissioners only had a choice of three machines. From the three machines, they were all optic scan. So you're not dealing with a choice. It's just a matter of company A, B, or C, and who can give you the fastest, best service with the amount of people that are in your city, county.
I always tell them, let's make a deal, somebody in the back room knows somebody.
That was said. I'm not going to say it wasn't, but I know commissioners were very frustrated because most of them did not want optic scan, and I call it paper guzzler. That's right. What it is, instead of a gasoline guzzler like a car. We just couldn't imagine the amount of paper that we were going to be needing.
And during the votes that people voted for me, it wouldn't take the write-in for some reason on some of them. They had to write a deposition or something that they were for this person.
And that's possible. That wasn't after
that
my
was
time.
Another crazy thing. Then even when I got the signatures, I have a list of all the Republicans, but it was 95 people that was registered Republicans or so were not registered Republicans. They threw it out for some reason. Either it wasn't legible or they wasn't Republicans. And that's what you go by that list. You're knocking every door. Mm-hmm. And people signed it. So that surprised me too. That's what they told me, to get at least double the amount of signatures.
Well, double the amount that they usually tell everyone. Yeah, doesn't matter if you're
And I should have listened to that. Mm-hmm. But doing it by myself was all summer, trying to do it.
Oh, it's difficult.
It was really something. Then the last election, they send you a card, and I vote at Brookside all the time. It's elementary school. They sent me the card. I go to Brookside. Everything's locked.
For the primary,
Oh, yeah, for the primary.
They probably consolidated.
Yeah, so what happened? They did. But they didn't tell anybody. I didn't get the card for that. But anyway, so then I knew that Mohansick School, it's another elementary school in New Yorktown. I went there. So the guy had a little machine. He says, no, you're in French Hill. So then I had to go to the third place. Mm-hmm. And then I was going crazy. Why didn't you send a card or something? Because it said Brookside the first time. But, some of these things just get you aggravated.
That by law, they're supposed to. And right. I don't think that law has changed, but I don't know.
If you were a person who wanted to vote and you've seen the closed, and you didn't follow through like I do.
Right, you go home
and you lose that vote. And there's very little people come out in the primary as it is. Mm-hmm. And those are some of the things that I see. But listen, people have all reasons why they don't vote. And I don't know why. Because
I'm going to Atlantic City today.
Yeah, right.
That was a famous one.
And then you try absentee ballot. Mm-hmm. And then they wouldn't tell you how many absentee ballots are when I was running. Because, people would sign and would have absentee ballots. I know people who are away that sign my name.
Right.
So I still don't know the total of what I have. She gave me an estimate, of how many people.
Well, they have to do a book at the end. Well, I say at the end of the year. It's usually the beginning of the next year. And it's Albany. And it's supposed to be all part of it, whether it's a local. I mean, obviously the state wants state offices, but it is something that we did produce. It was a re-canvass of the election of.
Oh, because maybe I'll give another call since I didn't get it.
I was so mad. We used to put some of that online because it was just geared towards Westchester.
Right.
I don't know about their website anymore.
Yeah.
As we talked, many of the forms you can get off of the state website.
Right. That's for the other people who want to run. The mm-hmm. state website gives you all the forms and stuff. But it's really a big project to do, especially running against incumbents or against your own party. And it just amazes me sometimes. But the best thing was, I think it was somebody died in the elections, during the election. And people
that
still
the year you ran? Oh, no.
No, in the elections.
Right.
And then that person gets votes.
Run.
Because nobody knows that he died.
Well, there's a time frame where you can't take someone's name off the ballot.
Yeah.
That was it.
Yeah. And then one other guy, Alan Hevesy, who was arrested or mm-hmm. convicted, mm-hmm. and his name was still on the ballot. Mm-hmm. And nobody knew the new guy. So they said, well, he was doing a good job, even though he was a crook.
Yeah.
And they voted for him, and he won the election. These are just some of the
things that happened. I found that out shortly after I became commissioner, and I'm not going to even say who the candidate was. I mean, he was an extremely nice man, but he did get in trouble, and I believe he might have even been in jail, but it was too late to take his name off, yeah. And he won.
He won, right?
And, of course, you know, like, then it's a special election. Mm-hmm. Death, that has happened a couple of times, too, where it was too late. Yeah. And I could be wrong, but I think it's like about 7 days before the election, and there's just no way the name can come off.
Right, and then they can replace it with the guy's wife. I think I've seen
usually in state offices, and it might even be down. I know one year there was a gentleman who was a county legislator, and he was from Yonkers, and he did pass away, and I can't remember his name right at the time. And there was a short time frame where his wife maybe was going to.
They can do that.
But she ended up not. So,
okay.
But I the name will probably come to me about 10 o'clock tonight.
Yeah. So listen, you spent 20 years there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
So now you're retired for the last 2 years.
Yes.
So I know you still vote.
Oh, absolutely! Okay. If I'm not here, I do an absentee.
Okay. So what do you do with your life? Because you know that's stress and strain, and it's got to be in that short period of time. I don't know what happens over the whole year.
Well, it got worse as we got more elections to do. So it didn't get better. You used to have some downtime, but by the time I left, we always kidded and said, you know, what downtime?
Yeah, okay. So what are you doing with yourself? You got a couple minutes left.
Well, sleep better, much better.
Oh, that's good.
I do go to New York City. I see plays a lot. I love cultural museums. I meet with friends that are also retired that I could not see before because I was always working and, you know, they were going about. I do have a beautiful complex I live in, Briarcliff Woods in Ossining, and we have a nice pool. So I spend a lot of the summer around there, and there's another group of friends. We go out to eat every once in a while and have our cocktail parties around the pool, which is enjoyable. But the big thing is I do go out to Tucson, Arizona, for the winter, which was always my goal. I used to run out there for a couple of weeks, but I went out for 3 months the first year, and then I went out for 5 months
last year.
So listen, I love it.
Well, that's great. It must be hot as hell out
there.
No, not too bad.
It's not bad.
Not too bad. Okay. Now I want you to look at camera three. Mm-hmm. Now there was an old guy saying, "I want you to vote." You know, Uncle Sam?
Yes.
Now, I want you to say something to those people that are watching, no matter what age and who they are, yes, to get them out to vote. So, look around.
What I can tell you is it is a privilege. It's an honor. And many people of all ages and nationalities go out there and keep that very precious for us. And you should think before you go and vote. And by all means, take the time, as I've often said, if you are willing to stand online to watch Robert Redford in a movie or Beyonce or someone like that sing, and you all know at one time or another there was someone that you would stand online for hours. It doesn't take all that long, but even if it does, you do it once every year, and some people don't even do it once every year. It's worth the wait to vote.
Okay, listen, thanks so much for being on the show.
Thank you.
And like you said, it's a privilege to vote, and hope everybody gets out to
vote.
I
hope so, too.
All right, thank you so much. Listen, folks, that was Carolee Sunderland, former commissioner of the Board of Elections. I want to thank you for watching. We try to keep it interesting. This is another thing. And listen, if you want to go out there and run, go to the Board of Elections, get the packet, or look up the state, and run and make changes. That's what I try to do. Thanks again for coming so much, right?
Thanks for having me.
Good night, folks.